So I'd like to introduce to you today Dr. Lisa Buda. She is the Chief Dental Director of the Blende Dental Group. The Blende Dental Group specializes in full mouth rehabilitation of medically compromised, phobic, and special needs patients under general anesthesia and IV sedation. Dr. Buda is on staff with active operating room privileges at California Pacific Medical Center and Kaiser Permanente Hospitals in San Francisco.
Thank you. So today I'm going to talk about something that everyone here should be interested in, and that's something that's not generally covered in many of these talks, and that's oral health in dementia. So there are a large number of caregivers in the audience today and people who manage caregivers. So my goal today is to help you understand how to best take care of the oral health of patients who have dementia and related illnesses. We'll talk about the caregiver's role in providing oral hygiene, and I'll provide a basic understanding of oral health and hygiene. The idea behind this is that if you as a caregiver or care manager have an understanding of how to take care of your own teeth and have an understanding of what's going on in your mouth, you may be able to transfer that information to your patient's mouth or the resident's mouths. So I'll demonstrate oral hygiene techniques and give you some strategies for products and things that you can do to make it easier and more effective. Obviously, when you're doing this for someone else, it's infinitely more difficult than doing it for yourself. So that's the direction in which we'll be going. And finally, I'll discuss options for treatment of patients ranging from in the home. We make house calls. There are many dentists who are able to do this, as well as some of the schools. And treatment in the dental office or even in the hospital if that's necessary. So poor oral health affects people in many different ways and sometimes in ways that you wouldn't even realize. It has an impact on the quality of the diet someone can eat, whether it's a liquid diet, a puree diet, a soft diet, and this in turn affects the nutritional content of their food, and that affects their general health. Appearance and social interactions are affected by poor oral health. Patients may be less social due to tooth loss or tooth pain. They may be embarrassed to eat with other people. And even if they have dementia, this is certainly something that is very, very important. And if they don't have any teeth, you may think, well, they have dentures. This isn't any longer an issue. However, with age, people don't clean their dentures as well. They need help with age. The gums start to recede, the bone starts to melt away, and dentures don't fit as well. So even someone with dentures needs to make sure that they're seeing a dentist, that someone is taking care of their gums and making sure that their dentures fit properly. And we'll also talk about how to clean the denture and how to remove it and insert it so that you have an idea of how that works as well. General health is most certainly affected by oral health. Our mouths are connected to the rest of our bodies, and an infection in the mouth can travel to other parts of the body and have multi-systemic effects. This was most apparent in a case in Petaluma a few years ago. There was a woman who was in the nursing home there, and she died due to a dental infection, and the state actually fined the nursing home due to neglect. Nobody ever looked in the woman's mouth. They thought that she had full dentures, but an infection in her mouth traveled, and it ended up that she wasn't able to breathe. Our teeth are connected, you know, to the rest of our system, and once the infection travels to the neck, it closes off the airways and the breathing passages, and it can travel very, very quickly. It becomes an emergency situation. So anytime you see someone, one of your residents or one of your patients who stops eating or begins to eat differently or complains of pain and anywhere in the mouth, is very, very important for them to see a dentist. It's important for them to see a dentist regularly, so it doesn't get to that point where their behavior is changing. But when that happens, it's critical. So my premise is that the challenge of optimal oral health is in the caregiver's responsibility when it comes to special needs patients. Now, from dietary decisions to completion of an oral hygiene regime, it's the caregiver who needs to understand this and not necessarily the patient. And obviously, dementia is on a spectrum. So you'll start with patients who may have some role in their oral hygiene, maybe very insistent in having that role, and that's wonderful and that's important. But at the end of the day, it's really the caregiver's responsibility to make sure the oral hygiene is being completed. The issue I see most often is a caregiver who believes that putting a toothbrush in a patient's mouth or giving a patient a toothbrush is completion of the oral hygiene routine. And it's very, very unfortunate that that's just not the case. For this population of patients, we really need to know exactly what we're doing, making sure all of the food and all the debris is being removed, as well as potentially using some products that are going to make the job easier, potentially using more fluoride or using some remineralizing pastes. And I'll talk about those a little bit later. So today I'm going to talk about a little bit of how you as a caregiver can implement these strategies. So let's start with something simple. What causes tooth decay? And whether I go into a room of PhD candidates, very, very, very smart people, or I go into a room of kindergartners, the answer will most likely be the same. And that is sugar. That is the case and that isn't the case. Now, certainly sugar is a fermentable carbohydrate, and when you put a fermentable carbohydrate into a mouth that's filled with bacteria that will consume fermentable carbohydrates, the bacteria will produce acid. And actually, it's not sugar necessarily, it's acid that causes cavities. So anything that is a fermentable carbohydrate is the enemy. And it's the acid that's really causing it, that's really causing the decay. There are actually four things that are needed for this cavity to form. We have a tooth surface. A patient without teeth won't get cavities. They'll get different types of dental disease and oral diseases, but not cavities. So you need a tooth surface, a caries or cavity-causing bacteria, and that's something like strep mutans, strep sabrinus, lactobacillus. Those are all caries-causing bacteria, and fermentable carbohydrates and thyme. The way this happens, like I said, is the bacteria consume the fermentable carbohydrate, they make acid, and that creates the cavity. So every time we eat, we're causing cavities. It's more frequency than anything. So that's where you come in as a caregiver, not only with the oral hygiene, but with providing food, monitoring snacking, monitoring diet. So for about 20 minutes after we eat, we're creating an acidic environment. And that acidic environment is what destroys the teeth. Now you might think, well, why only 20 minutes? What happens the rest of the time? And that's where saliva comes in. So after about 20 minutes, saliva, which we all have in our mouths in varying quantities, will wash away the acid. And our teeth are, again, at a pH which will allow them to maintain their mineralization. At a pH of less than 5.5, our teeth begin to demineralize. At a pH greater, they can remineralize. So our teeth are in a constant state of demineralization and remineralization. So the more often that the pH drops below 5.5, the more cavities a patient is going to develop. Now, it's like I said, it's the acid and not necessarily the sugar that's causing the cavities. So without talking about sugar, we can talk about Coke. Coke has a pH of 2.5. So anytime you consume Coke, that's less than 5.5. I see you with that Coke bottle in your hand. So every time you take a sip of that, not good for your teeth. So for your teeth, it's better to really have that entire bottle in one sitting rather than sipping on it, because sipping on it 20 minutes after you take every sip, your teeth are demineralizing. So Coke's 2.5, lemons at about 2. And something as seemingly benign as carbonated water has actually a pH of 3. So it's the carbonic acid. So not only are we going to worry about fermentable carbohydrates, we have to worry about anything that's acidic. So got to cut the snacking. So now we know the most important factors are frequency and duration. Hard candy that stays in the mouth is very, very harmful. That's because you have constantly this acidic environment that's in the mouth for however long as the hard candy is there. The elderly may put it in their cheek and they're just sitting there with it. It's bad. If they like to do that, get them xylitol candy. Xylitol is a non-fermentable sugar, and it actually decreases it. I like to tell kids it constipates the bacteria, which is true because it doesn't allow them to produce the acid, which causes tooth decay. So realizing this, caregiver's responsibility is not just keeping the teeth clean, it's making sure that the patient's diet is suitable and the patient isn't snacking too much or consuming too many acidic or sugary foods. Now, there's not in the mouth, we not only have dental decay, we also have periodontal disease. And this becomes very, very important when we start talking about elderly patients because it's very common in elderly patients. So if you look at the picture here, it's just like Shakespeare said, it's becoming long in the tooth. And the longer the tooth appears in the mouth, the less bone is holding the tooth in the mouth. So with bacteria, you're getting bacteria around that tooth, around the gum line, around the bone. The more bacteria you have, the more that the bone melts away and the less the tooth is anchored in the bone. So it's very, very important to keep the mouth clean in order to reduce the amount of bacteria and maintain as much bone as possible. Now, one thing that is very shocking to people sometimes is how loose the teeth actually are. Now, what you're seeing on the left side of the screen is a patient's mouth, and the white part around the gum is actually calculus. And that's what happens to plaque as it gets hard. If plaque isn't removed every day, then it will get hard because all the minerals in the saliva, which saliva is wonderful, but the minerals in saliva will actually mineralize the plaque and make it hard and very, very difficult for you to remove, if not impossible. At that moment, you need a hygienist or a dentist with metal instruments to remove the calculus. On the right is an x-ray, and you can see that the tooth is obviously in the mouth, but it's certainly not in the bone. So if that patient were to bite down onto a hard apple or something very, very tough, that tooth is coming out. And our biggest fear for this elderly population of patients is that that tooth or bacteria from that tooth are going to end up in the lung and cause something called aspiration pneumonia. So it's really very, very dangerous once the teeth become loose like that. Now, not only are the links between oral and systemic health quite that clear where you have a tooth in the mouth that may or may not end up in the lung, but there are many other ways in which oral health is tied to systemic health. So you're reducing patients' complications from pneumonia, aspirate pneumonia. If the person has had radiation therapy, they are at risk of having a decreased amount of saliva if they've had radiation therapy to the head or neck. Also, something I'll really get into later, if the patient is on many different medications, which many, as we saw from the last lecture, many of these patients with dementia are on a wide variety of medications, the amount of saliva in their mouth has been greatly decreased. When saliva is decreased, you don't have the buffering capacity of that liquid that allows for the acidity to go away after 20 minutes. Once a patient has less saliva, the acidity is staying in their mouth for a much longer amount of time. So going back to dry mouth, the technical term for this is xerostomia. Now, because of the number of medications, it's very, very common in this population. Saliva not only buffers the acidity, but it forms a protective film for the teeth. There's calcium and phosphate in saliva, which remineralize the enamel. There are little proteins called mucins that trap bacteria from the mouth so that instead of going to the lung, they can be swallowed and go into the stomach where they can be destroyed by acids. And when we think about saliva, we can imagine that the ocean is saliva and kelp on the beach is plaque on the teeth. When the ocean washes up onto the beach, it can take away the plaque and the acidity. But when the ocean is dry, when the mouth is dry, the kelp just stays on the beach and the plaque and all the bacteria and all the acids just stay on the teeth. So it's kind of a good visual way of thinking about what the function of saliva really is. And once the plaque stays on the teeth, it hardens into calculus and causes periodontal disease and all the complications that we mentioned. Now, xerostomia is generally present in about 17 to 29% of the general population. That's the general population. If you're looking at the number of people who are on medications in your population of patients, I would say it's almost 100% of the elderly population with dementia. So it's a very, very big deal. Now, these are some of the drugs that cause xerostomia, and you can see that it's anticholinergics, antidepressants, antipsychotics, sedatives, analgesics. It's with the number of drugs that a patient is on, the risk of xerostomia only increases. It's an additive effect. These are the patients who don't have the advantage of protective saliva. So if their mouths aren't being cleaned, and that really doesn't mean just taking a toothette or a towel and just swiping at the teeth, because that's not cleaning. We need to make sure that at least their diet is conducive to preventing dental disease. So that's something we'll talk about. So we want to make sure that person has an established oral hygiene routine with a skilled caregiver, and that's someone who knows how to take care of the patient's teeth, but also within that has an understanding of what's going on in their own mouth. So if a person has xerostomia, they may actually not have any symptoms. However, once they do have symptoms, it's more than likely that half of the saliva that they had before is actually gone, and they may experience burning, soreness, and difficulty with swallowing or altered taste. In dementia patients and the elderly population in general, the difficulty with swallowing is especially dangerous because of the risk of aspiration pneumonia. You may notice that these patients have an increased need to sip water when they're swallowing, and they might avoid certain foods that are stickier or a little thicker. And this will most definitely affect their nutrition. Now, it is also actually quite significant if a patient wears dentures. You may think, again, that, well, they wear dentures, it doesn't matter if they have enough saliva. But especially the upper denture, it relies on a seal. And so when there's not a lot of saliva, the upper denture will simply fall out. It will not stay. So it's very, very important that even a patient who wears dentures is being treated for xerostomia. And when the denture moves around like that, it's not sticking, the patient will have sore spots, and it will develop it may develop ulcers under the denture. There are many different things that you can do once a patient does have xerostomia. There are rinses, something called biotin. It's very, very helpful. It comes in a rinse, it comes in a toothpaste, and it actually also comes in a spray. There are xylitol mints, xylitol gum. This will help to stimulate saliva. And you want to make sure that these patients are rinsing often with water or alcohol-free mouthwash. After they eat, if they can rinse and spit, great. If they can't rinse and spit, have them at least drink water after they're eating or after they're having juice or any liquid that isn't water, really. Now, there are many challenges to oral care for this population of patients, but at the same time, there are also advantages. Some of the challenges are specific to the patient, such as the inability to provide their own care and their inability to express discomfort. But others are challenges, yet also advantages for the caregiver. And that's this ability to control the diet and then manage the frequency and quality of the patient's oral hygiene. Unfortunately, there are many people who come to me and say, well, this patient can't take care of his own teeth. Why keep the teeth? Why fix the teeth? It doesn't make any sense to do it. But I don't think people realize how much basic satisfaction is derived from simply eating a meal. There was actually an experiment with the astronauts, and they tried to experiment with a liquid diet for the astronauts just because it was easier to package, easier to manage up in space. And they wouldn't accept it. They weren't able to consume it. They weren't able to do it. There are people who are mute, and they have the option of, I'm sorry, there are people who are unable to swallow, and they have a dysphagia, and the option to cure this is to perform a surgery so that they can swallow, not be tube-fed, yet it will render them mute. And people choose to do this because they want that simple satisfaction of chewing and swallowing food, which is quite shocking if you really think about it. So what do we do to keep these patients' teeth clean? What can you do? What tools can I offer you? And there are several. There's something as simple as making sure that the toothbrush that you're using is something that is reasonable and will remove plaque with the least effort, and that could be an electric toothbrush or something called a callus curve or specialized care toothbrush. I'll also show you different floss aids and a product called MI paste, and I'll go through all of these individually. electric toothbrush is great because it vibrates or rotates, and it allows the caregiver to actually expend less energy. You don't have to worry about moving around. You just position yourself in one way and go all the way around the mouth. And many of these toothbrushes actually have a two-minute timer, with 2 minutes is about the amount of time that you want to spend. So you divide the mouth into four quadrants. You spend 30 seconds in each quadrant, and you make sure that you get to all the surfaces of the teeth. So that's the cheek surface, the tongue surface, the chewing surface, and now we have two more surfaces. And that's the surfaces on the side, what we call the interproximal surfaces. Those won't necessarily be cleaned by a toothbrush. You have to get to floss aids to use that. But an electric toothbrush is terrific because it will actually vibrate and get under just slightly underneath the gum line with very, very little energy from you. Not all patients will accept it, but some of the children's toothbrushes, they have a setting that it'll start from a very, very low setting, and then it'll increase in the vibrations. They tend to tickle when you first start using them, and a patient may not be all that excited about that. But if you start from a very low setting, it may be a little bit more useful. Two different manual toothbrushes you can get are the Collis Curve and the Surround toothbrush. These brush all the surfaces of the teeth at the same time. It's a less expensive option, and it's quite helpful. All of the studies show that this is better than a regular manual toothbrush in brushing these patients' teeth. There are different oral hygiene aids that you could use. What you see on the left is a mouth prop, which we actually use very often in our practice, and it's made out of a soft foam, and you just put it in sideways and twist it slightly just to allow the patient to open their teeth, and it's not going to hurt them. It's actually quite soft and quite pleasant. There's also something like this called a metal retractor, and we use this all the time as well in conjunction with the mouth prop, and it just helps you see. A lot of these patients will tend to pucker, like you see in the top photo on the right there. And once they pucker it, even with the foam mouth prop, it's very, very difficult to get in there. But this, although it might look like it's not very gentle, it actually is quite gentle. You just moisten the sides and pull away the cheek, and it's quite comfortable. And generally, the patients aren't quite as cooperative as the one you see on the left there, unfortunately. Also, different modifications you can make to a regular toothbrush in order to make it easier to hold if a patient's still at the stage where they are trying to do as much of their own oral hygiene as possible. You can do hand over hand with one of these to make it a little bit more simple for them. Just modify it by using a tennis ball or wrapping it around their hand, using a bicycle grip. Just couple things. This is from the National Institute of Health. It's a document they have online. If you email me, I can give you the link to it. It's all free information that they have. It's really quite good. And here are some floss aids that, it's very, very difficult to get into your own mouth. You take with some floss. Now, getting into someone else's mouth is even harder, and it's certainly necessary if the teeth are in contact. It doesn't only clean where the teeth are touching. The important part of using floss is to clean just below the gum line. It prevents periodontal disease, and it helps to make sure that the fifth and sixth surface of the teeth are clean, that all the areas that the toothbrush can't get to. So when you're doing oral hygiene for somebody else, it's very important to keep them safe, but also to keep you safe. And you can do that if they're in a chair. You can do that by putting a lock on the wheelchair, making sure you're standing behind them, either leaning up against a wall or leaning over them, and having a mouth prop or a foam or the metal retractor in one hand and using your other hand in order to provide care. This is sometimes easier with two people. And you can use different techniques like distraction, perhaps having them watch TV while they do it, maybe a brightly lit bathroom. If bright lights are not calming to them, which they aren't to many people, a brightly lit bathroom may not be the best place. Every patient is different, and everybody will have a little bit of a different reaction to different environments. So perhaps having an activity board on their lap, or a picture that they like to look at, or having them watch TV while the oral hygiene routine is being performed may be a good way to distract them. So another product that's very, very good is MI paste. And this comes in two formulations. One is with fluoride and one is without, depending on the patient. And it actually has calcium and phosphate to help remineralize the teeth. and reduce sensitivity. Many elderly patients won't have sensitivity, but it is a nice option if it's necessary. And this is used just by taking a pea-sized amount on a finger and really just rubbing it on the teeth. This can stay in overnight. In fact, it's supposed to stay in overnight, and it helps prevent decay. So a little primer on making sure that everybody knows how to insert and remove a denture. For the upper dentures, just put your fingers right at the top, right where a denture meets the gingiva or the gum line, and you just pull down. The upper dentures generally have a little bit of a seal to them, so you'll hear a pop, and that's how you make sure that they're removed. They do need to be cleaned, so afterwards you need to make sure that you're putting them in a denture cleaner, brushing them with a brush. For lower dentures, it's usually much more simple. Just push up with your thumbs or with your index fingers, making sure that they're removed that way. And you can rock back and forth. That's not going to hurt the patient. And of course, they should never be worn at night. Really never, ever be worn at night. And that it's because it could cause sore spots and also a fungus called candidiasis. And you'll see that if you look in the patient's mouth. They've been wearing dentures for a very long time. They'll have an inflamed red area, usually on the palate, and it'll have little white spots, and that's a sign of candidiasis. It's a very uncomfortable condition. So you really want to make sure that no one's wearing their denture at night. It's not bacteria at that point isn't the problem, it's fungus. So there are many different ways to manage the behavior of your patients with dementia, and that's very, very patient specific. Some of it has to do with just making sure you have the right tone. Some patients react much better to someone having a very soft tone, calm speaking voice. Everybody's different. You have to make sure you're in the right time and place. If evening is not good, maybe a little bit earlier is better. Of course, you want to make sure that the oral hygiene is being completed after meal times, but you also need to time it in a way that is going to be appropriate for that particular patient. Some patients may need to feel that they're having a little bit more control than others in their oral hygiene routine. So you can have them start the routine and then you finish, or hand over hand, where you have your hand on their hand as it's being completed. And there's also something called rescuing, where one caregiver may start the oral hygiene routine, the patient may be not reacting well to that, and another caregiver comes in and rescues the patient and finishes the routine. Really anything to try to get it done with them. And finally, of course, patience. It just takes a lot of patience to make sure that this is done for your residents. Now, what about when the patient needs dental treatment or when the resident needs dental treatment? And this hopefully is every single one, because they all should be having a regular checkup and regular exam just to make sure that nothing is going on. And there are many different modes that you could use. There's nitrous oxide, there's oral medications. This is for patients who are potentially a little bit more cooperative. But in the event that the patient needs a little bit more extensive treatment, or a tooth needs to come out, or something more needs to be done, there are also options for sedation. In the event that there is an infection, it needs to be taken care of. We don't want a patient to be on antibiotics for the rest of their life. And there are many options to do this. Many of the schools offer hospital dental care, where a patient could be put to sleep and treatment could be done. In our office, we actually do house calls, and we go out to patients' homes, do exams, sometimes do treatment in the home, either under oral medications or awake normally, because some patients are able to tolerate that. And then sometimes we do take them into the hospital to do a little bit more extensive treatment under general anesthesia with a physician anesthesiologist. After the patient has had dental care, we want to make sure that we maintain it. So we need to set these patients up with RDHAPs, and these are registered dental hygienists in alternative practice. They will actually come out to an assisted living home or the patient's residence and complete oral hygiene for them. They have a degree which allows them to practice independently, and it's actually only in California at this point. There are similar things in Washington and Oregon, but they're able to monitor the patient for oral diseases. They come out to you, and they can refer to a dentist if necessary. So as caregivers, what could you look for? You want to make sure you're looking at swollen or red gums, any bleeding, sores, or lesions on the cheeks, the tongue, lips, or palate. Oral cancer screenings are very, very important. In the elderly population, smoking was much more common, and they have a higher incidence of oral cancer than there is in today's younger population, obviously. You want to make sure that the dentures are fitting properly, that the patient doesn't have sores or lesions. You want to look for candidiasis or those little white spots under the dentures, because that will be very uncomfortable for the patient. Looking for plaque accumulation, making sure the patient's teeth are being cleaned, the plaque staying on the teeth, it's going to cause a lot of buildup of calculus, bad breath, and broken or loose teeth. Of course, bad breath means bacteria, and we want to get the bacteria out of the mouth. And broken or loose teeth come a risk for aspiration pneumonia. So you're welcome to contact me for more information. This is my email address. I know that the PowerPoint slides were not included in your packet, so if you'd like a copy of the PowerPoint, I'm more than willing to send it out to you. And are there any questions? Sure, could you email me, please? Or great. No problem. Mm-hmm. Definitely after breakfast. Their brushing should be done at least twice a day. If the patient with a higher rate of decay or xerostomia, really after every time they eat, would be best. At least rinsing with water or a fluoridated mouth rinse. If they're able to rinse and spit, a fluoridated mouth rinse would be terrific. But the oral hygiene should be completed after breakfast, for sure, definitely. It does not. Well, you want to make sure, so the question was, does if sugar-free candy caused acid. Xylitol is the one that causes the least xylitol candy. So if you look at something with xylitol as a first ingredient, that's really the best. One issue with xylitol is if quite a lot of it is consumed, it can cause gastric upset. So just like you don't want to eat too much candy in general, probably too much xylitol is also not so good. But certainly if for the purpose of stimulating saliva, mint xylitol candy or lemon flavored xylitol candy will do a great job. Just not too much of it, just like anything. Go ahead. So the question was if for house calls, if we take Medi-Cal patients, and Nicole actually takes care of all of the insurance questions. I don't do a lot of that, but I know we try to make things work. We're not a Medicare provider, but we try to make things work for sure for all the patients we can. Good. We travel within a 60-mile radius of the office, and obviously if there's someone who really needs our care, we go further than that as well.
With the law as it reads today is that nursing homes are required only when they're doing the oral hygiene assessment, it has to be done by either a physician or an RN, neither of whom have had adequate training in dentistry. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of the dental problems in facilities are not picked up. And so if they're not picked up, it's not put into the routine care plan, and it just goes on and on and on until we have, like you mentioned, that death that happened. Was it Calistoga? No, not Calistoga.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, exactly. Oral hygiene is so basic to common to basic good health. I'm suggesting that if you're a nursing home, that you think about hiring or contracting with a registered dental hygienist professional in alternative practice, because they will provide you with what's missing in the assessment process. And you will get better care as a result. They will also train your staff on the day-to-day oral practices for good oral hygiene. But thank you for bringing this up. I'm so glad they had you here today. Many thanks.
No, thank you. And I absolutely agree. We have many registered dental hygienists in alternative practice. And if you'd like some names, we can certainly give them to you. They're very, very well trained. Go ahead. I'm sorry, could you say that again?
I said you didn't mention water picks when you were talking about dental hygiene. I was just curious why the omission.
No, water picks are great. They're certainly, They're great. They do make a mess sometimes, and sometimes it's difficult because these patients have difficulty with swallowing. But certainly, it's on a patient to patient basis. If a patient will tolerate a water pick, fantastic. Anything that will remove plaque. I'm getting a 1 minute warning, so unless there are any burning questions, I'm going to be at the booth right outside there, and if there are any more questions, I'm more than welcome to answer them.